little introduction. The four of us have talked about this issue that we're going to discuss today for several years, and we decided that this would be a great venue for us to bring it out. And it's really around, while we're all primarily working in the electricity industry, the critical infrastructure industry more broadly is very—it's similarly applicable to the conversation today. So I'm going to have each of the panelists introduce themselves, and then we'll jump into some questions. And we're going to save about 10 minutes at the end to take audience questions. So please write them down and don't be bashful about asking anything really hard, because the diversity up here in industry experience, I think we can kind of handle anything. So I'll start with Tom.
Yeah. Thank you, Marc. Sorry about that, Art. Here, you can have mine instead. My name is Tom Alrich. I'm an independent consultant to the electric power industry, as well as to security vendors to the industry. I specialize in the NERC CIP cybersecurity standards, and I've been working in this area previously for Honeywell and for Deloitte. Since 2010, I've been writing about developments in the CIP standards, and I've write a blog called Tom Alrich's Blog, which gets a lot of attention in the industry now, both from the utilities and from the regulators. I don't expect you to agree with everything I say today, but I'd appreciate any comments, either positive or negative. And I'd like to point out that I'm facilitating a birds of a feather discussion on regulating cybersecurity in general, not just for the power industry. Today, from 12:30 to 1:15, at the Marriott Golden Gate A room, table H. And if any of you would like to join me, I hope you will, because it should be an interesting discussion. And you need to get there early, because there's only room for 8 people, and it's first come, first served. I've been delegated to give a short introduction to NERC CIP. NERC stands for the North American Electric Reliability Corporation. It's a nonprofit corporation owned by utilities and power industry participants that is charged with maintaining and upgrading the reliability of the bulk electric system, which means the kind of interstate wholesale power system. NERC is engaged by the Federal Energy Regulatory Commission, or FERC, to develop and audit mandatory reliability standards, and the NERC CIP standards are one part of the overall NERC family, although they get the most attention nowadays. So this is a brief discussion, and we'll go from there.
Thanks, Tom. Art?
My name is Art Conklin. I'm from the University of Houston. I'm not in the industry. I'm a professor, and my work and teaching students is all about securing critical infrastructure. Not so much in the electric sector, played a little bit in electricity, much more so in oil and gas pipelines, which seem to be much more in the news lately for a variety of silly reasons. But I look at infrastructure totally differently. Former naval officer, used to drive a ship on the ocean, and if the infrastructure doesn't work, it means, oh wait, you're not moving in the water. And that becomes real serious real quick. And our infrastructure is something that's hidden. We don't see it every day. We don't pay attention to it, but it has changed tremendously in the last 30 years. It's grown up with computers and lots of room for mischief and problems. And so that's the playground.
Thanks, Art. Mark.
Thank you, Mark. Good morning, everybody. Mark Sachs, and in last employ, I was the CSO at NERC, so I can now speak freely since I'm no longer at NERC. A lot of good things we're doing there. The critical infrastructure world for all of us, as Art just mentioned, is a thing we can see, and there's large parts of things we cannot see. I'm also a former Army officer. I didn't drive a ship, but rode on one time. But my job there was more of a destructive thing, you know, blow things up, blow up targets, you know, kill the enemy's infrastructure. In power and oil and other key areas, there is still a large amount of physical stuff. a lot of the CIP standards apply to the physical world, things like tree trimming and barriers and proper separation of things. We're playing with laws of physics that have to be obeyed. And oftentimes we can quantify in a regulation or in some sort of standard things that define laws of physics, you know, physical separation of things and so forth. When it comes to cyber, it's a little different because there are no laws there that we've uncovered yet, as far as we know. And so trying to quantify those natural laws of cyberspace into something that can then become a regulatory thing is a challenge. So most of our cyber regulations have become more of outcome-based. You know, we want to prevent a certain thing from happening, or we want to achieve this goal, but we're not going to tell you how to get there. And I think that's something that's, we can dig into this a little bit later, is to, if you want to describe a regulation, well, how exactly would it be? You know, is how deep do you want to go? How prescriptive? Because there's so many ways you can solve these problems. And most of us understand in the cyber world, if you try and nail something down to into a checklist or a step-by-step list, by the time it's published, it's out of date because somebody, one of art students, has already figured out how to go around it, and now you're back to square one again, having to redraw the books.
So you've heard the word standards has come up from each of the panelists here already this evening and or this morning, and so that's kind of where we're going to focus. But so Art, before we let's level set here just a little bit. Before we get going, we're going to talk about standards and critical infrastructure. What is critical? How do you define critical?
Critical is actually an interesting term because I view critical like beauty. It's in the eyes of the beholder at the end of the day. So the federal government's going to view critical infrastructure as something that affects the entire nation as a whole. Well, the bulk electric grid, that qualifies. But let's ask Atlanta what critical with cyber infrastructure and critical infrastructure is like, or maybe just their airport recently, and it suddenly becomes more local. Or ask your neighbor who has a child on a ventilator, when the electricity goes out, do they really care about the electricity in the whole Northeast corridor, only to their house? And so at the end of the day, the way I've always preached it to the students is simple. If it affects life or well-being, then the beholder sees it as critical. And you know, the airline industry, there was one airplane recently, became very critical, made it in the news. Got down to the ground safely, that's cool. So what is critical? It varies. And that's one of the biggest problems with this idea of setting a standard or regulating, because at what level are we going to play that game?
Yeah, so DHS actually has, up 3 years ago, there were 18 critical infrastructure sectors in the United States. They redefined that down to 16, and then last year they added voting as a critical infrastructure. So today there are, defined by the federal government, 17 critical infrastructure sectors. So Tom, so I think what Art said makes sense. Why can't we use the cyber regulation from other domains like PCI and HIPAA and you know, some of the financial regulations? Why don't they apply just as equally in this critical infrastructure area?
Yeah, the reason is that we're dealing with control systems here, and those regulations, HIPAA, PCI, almost any other cyber regulation you point to, deal with information, protecting information. So with control systems, you want to protect control. And the best example of that is the first attack in the Ukraine, where somebody, whoever it was, caused a large outage. And you can see on YouTube video of a screen in the control room of one of these utilities there. And the cursor is moving around the screen and opening up circuit breakers. And when you open a circuit breaker, you trip a line. And so a bunch of people go into darkness. And they couldn't do anything about it because they had lost control of the system. So that's what you're trying to protect against. Information is not at all important except the information on the configuration of the device itself. Because when the attackers, again, whoever they were, were preparing for this attack, they first learned all about the systems, and they were able to, you know, get information from them to learn exactly how they're configured so they could attack them. So you do need to protect that information, but your end goal is protection of control, not information.
So Marc said, Tom mentioned the Ukraine attacks in 2015, 2016. Coming back to America, to the United States, the CIP standards, Critical Infrastructure Protection Standards, designed for the bulk power system, are they doing enough? I mean, are they, in light of the Ukrainian events, are CIP standards doing enough?
Yeah, that's a fair question. It's a question we received often after both of those events have happened, because, you know, there's a lot of fear here in the United States that somebody could blink the lights in Boston or, you know, cause catastrophic cascading failures. One of the things Tom was just talking about kind of leads up to this with, in the financial world, when we talk about privacy, you know, which is what PCI and these other things are doing, or HIPAA for healthcare, that's more of a confidentiality issue, so we're protecting information from disclosure that they don't want to see. For a control system, what the thing is controlling and whether a line is active or not, or if a breaker is set or not set or something, who cares? You know, if your adversary knows that the volts are working, well, they can hack your system and find that out, you know, do a confidentiality attack, or they can just observe and see, yeah, the lights are on. Okay, so there's the confidentiality is not that big of a deal. The problem we face is more of an integrity issue. You don't want somebody to go in and change settings, you know, tell a breaker to do something else or tell a generator that something's going on. And this is sort of what happened in Ukraine. Was way before the attack happened, there was just basic phishing, and they were able to hook into the enterprise systems and get usernames and passwords. So mistake number one was the phishing campaign worked. Mistake number two was that usernames and passwords used on the enterprise side were also used on the control side. So then when the adversaries later wanted to get into the control side and do an integrity style attack, even if they'd had all this confidentiality stuff in place, the fact that they were reusing their usernames and passwords over on the control side, allowing the adversary literally just to log in and replay legitimate credentials, now they can go in and start looking at things not to learn confidentiality, but to make changes, again, an integrity problem. So the standards we have here, the CIP standards, are focused on reliability. And that's a key word, okay? So we want to make sure that power is reliable. And that means a lot of things. Not only that it's on, but the frequencies are proper, they're balanced properly, you know, that the lights in here will just always work. Mm-hmm. And so control is what brings that reliability about. And so the CIP standards oriented on reliability have lots of check pieces in place. One of which is this thing about you don't use the same usernames and passwords on the enterprise side as you do over on the control side. You also guard and protect remote access. You log remote access. You have barriers and things in place. The Ukrainians don't have that same sort of mindset, and to their disadvantage, they are running the old Soviet system. So just geopolitically, Ukraine, you know, shares a border with Russia, and that old electrical infrastructure was a grid set up by the Soviet Union. So you have engineers on both sides that understand both technologies. It would be kind of like here in the United States if a bunch of engineers in Virginia wanted to go after a power system in Maryland. Well, yeah, it's interconnected. It's the same stuff. We all understand it. That kind of geopolitical thing really doesn't exist here. If the Russians wanted to come after us, their Russian power system doesn't interconnect with the United States. So we have to kind of step back and peel back a bit. We find out that we do a lot of good things here in North America. There's a lot of things we can do to improve. But the way that the actual way the Ukrainian thing worked out probably would not happen here because of stuff that we have in place to prevent that specific set of events. But that doesn't mean that another set of events couldn't happen here. So we never want to say it's impossible to break into the grid or impossible to do these types of disruptions. But the way it happened in Ukraine probably won't happen here because of things we have in place to prevent that style of technology. And one final comment, we learned a lot by studying Ukraine. We looked at that video that you talked about.
You guys spent a lot of time over there.
Yeah, sent teams over, met with the Ukrainians. We turned right around and built a roadshow here in the United States and in Canada to educate utility operators here. Here's exactly how whoever the adversary was, whether it's Russia or some hackers or whatever, but here are the specific steps that they used. Here are the things to look for in your systems that might indicate that they're trying to do the same sort of thing here. So lots of lessons learned, lots of lessons passed along. But we did an exhaustive review of the CIP standards, and be honest, we couldn't really find it, other than some basic tweaking, we didn't find any gaping holes that said, wow, we completely missed this method of attack. So we feel sort of confident that that methodology won't work here, but that doesn't mean that those adversaries can't find another methodology that might find their way through something that we've already developed reliability standards for.
Any thoughts? Anyone else? Okay, I'm going to put Tom on the spot here. So I say this without any reservation. I think Tom Alrich knows more about SIP standards than anybody in the world. He writes about them. By the way, if you're in the electricity industry and you don't just subscribe to Tom's blog, you're missing. I don't know where he gets the time to do it, but his blogs are fascinating, and he has a great sense of humor too, the way he writes. But so, Tom, one of the things you've written about is a little bit contrary to what Marc just said about rewriting the SIP standards to be more reflective of current reality. So, should a new standards framework apply to other sectors of the energy industry, like oil and gas and water and some of the other ones, and how might they apply to other industries outside of energy?
Yeah, thanks, Marc. Briefly, the way I would rewrite the SIP standards is kind of three principles. One is that they be non-prescriptive. They don't tell you how to do something, and this is more or less what Marc Sachs was saying, that you want to give the person the objective but not the actual, how they're going to do it. That should be up to them. The next one is that they should be based on threats, and the threats should be updated on a regular basis. One big problem with SIP now is that there are many threats, phishing, ransomware, APTs, you name it, that are not addressed at all in SIP, and frankly never will be, because you have to go through this multi-year standards development process with votes and ballots and approval by NERC and by FERC, and then a big implementation.
How long does it take?
Right. Well, it's at least three, the version 5 standards took 8 years from when they started working on them. So it's a broken system, unfortunately, and it has no way of accommodating new threats as they come on. And so there needs to be a way so that all threats are basically addressed. I would essentially have one requirement saying address all the threats on the current list. And the list gets maintained on a regular basis. And your job is to address on a risk-adjusted basis each of those threats, based on the risk they pose to your organization. So with that, this framework then, I would have separate kind of applicability sections. And for the power industry, you would say, okay, these standards apply to these devices, like relays and RTUs and control center servers and things like that. But then when you're talking about the natural gas pipeline industry, then you look at, say, well, these are devices that run compressor stations and underground storage facilities and sensors and actual actuators on the line mm-hmm. itself, et cetera. So so you can basically pop the applicability in and move from one critical energy sector to the next. However, this would not work in other industries like banking, finance, et cetera, mainly for the same reason we talked about earlier, which is that we're protecting information in those industries, not control.
How many people here are in the electricity or power industry? Okay, so you guys get this. You get this. I don't think hopefully you'd agree with what I'm getting ready to say. I don't think anyone would disagree that the SIP standards haven't made the electricity industry better. Yeah, they're a pain in the rear. They're really slow. So Art, my next question is to you. Compliance standards are slow to develop, and I think there's good reason for that. But the problem is, as we've kind of alluded to, the problem is that the threat and vulnerability environment doesn't follow the same glacial pace. So Art, how do we use the current regulatory environment to maintain relevancy when examined against these new kinds of threats, like, you know, Black Energy and Triton and whatever the next flavor of the day is?
If I had a YouTube video to describe this moment, it'd be Sigourney Weaver from the original Aliens movie when she says, "I say we just nuke the entire place from orbit." And the reason I say that is when your standards, if your compliance standards have to change with each and every new threat, then it leads to, well, you already hurt. You can't get there. You've already failed. And I look at the standards for what's going on in critical infrastructure is built by people, well-intentioned, good thoughts, but with an IT mindset. At the end of the day, if it all goes really wrong, we can just go to backup until that natural gas pipeline blows up and kills people and burns homes. And has that ever happened? A lot more than you realize. Mm-hmm. Pipeline explosions in the United States, they seem never to make the news, and I've never figured out why, but a couple times a year, a pipeline somewhere lets what's in it out. Sometimes it's poisonous, like ammonia, sometimes it blows up. These critical infrastructure things can't be fixed with a backup. You can't just say, "Oh, I'm sorry, Mark, can't you back your kids up? Mm-hmm. You didn't back them up. What about that house?" So we have to look at it totally differently. We have to look at it from an outcome standard. And I view this as a dilemma that we're facing in a lot of our big governmental driven initiatives. In the early 80s, I used to do sort of what Mark did in the military, which was break things and kill people. In Central America, my rules of engagement were 6 pages, and that determined whether I could pull a trigger and kill someone or not. Fast forward a few years later into the Persian Gulf, like 3.5 years later, and my rules of engagement were the size of a phone book, which were absolutely perfect if I was going to prosecute somebody after the fact for not following one of the rules. It did absolutely no good whatsoever for the guy that's trying to do the right action at the right time. And that's what we've done to the whole standards process. That's what we've done to the whole, any major government, let's fix, insert whatever your problem is here with something, let's make a huge, you know, 1800 page answer. And so, yeah, I think we have to nuke it from orbit and go to something like Tom was talking about, very objective, outcome oriented, and then let the players figure out how to do it.
Okay, so Tom, great follow on here. So I think we've established that, you know, the standards, while they're important, necessary, too slow. Does this mean that the electricity industry is not doing anything? I mean, are they sitting back being reactive to standards, or what are they doing?
No, actually, I think the power industry is definitely going well beyond the standards. You know, believe me, they're doing stuff about phishing, they're doing stuff about ransomware, APTs, even if they don't, you know, they're not required by CIP. But the problem is this gap is growing, but it's really a resource allocation problem. If you think of a CISO at the beginning of the year, they have a set budget that they want to allocate among the different threats that they have. And so they will look at the risk each threat poses, and they will, you know, budget according to that, and that's the way it should be. But if they have some mandatory standards to also follow, and those are just address a certain subset of those threats, then by golly, those are going to be the threats that they address first, because they have mandatory standards, and if they don't do them, they're going to get fined, and the fines for CIP are very substantial. So they have to over-allocate resources to those threats and under-allocate to, like, phishing and ransomware, which are, in my opinion, probably the two biggest threats nowadays. And so if there were a process where they just, it was mandatory, but they had to look at all the threats, and the list of threats was updated every 2 or 3 months rather than 5 or 6 years, then they would be essentially have to do the same thing they do without standards. But The difference is, that is, allocate based on the risk, but the difference there is it would be mandatory, and we want mandatory standards because that's how they get budget. You know, you just do not get the same amount of money to spend on cybersecurity if you don't have mandatory standards. And I don't think, you know, it shouldn't be any big surprise why that's the case, but it's definitely been the experience with CIP. So that's what a, you know, that's the what I would like to see as the framework.
Great. Everybody remember Metcalf incident? So Marc, question to you. So Metcalf, by the way, for anyone, it was the Metcalf substation was just down the road here, down 101. In 2013, somebody went and shot up a bunch of transformers. Fortunately, I thought of it at the time, this was a success story because the lights didn't even blink up here in San Francisco. Everything slipped, moved over, and transitioned just exactly the way it was supposed to. But it was an eye-opening experience for the electricity industry. There are about 45,000 substations scattered across the United States, some in very remote areas. So Marc, I think this was something that had been predicted. We kind of knew that a Metcalf could happen. The result of that was a new set of standards. Are the new standards, CIP 13, are they doing what we anticipated they would do?
So who was the CSO in 2013 at NERC?
What?
Who was the CSO in 2013 at NERC when Metcalf happened?
I left like the week before.
Oh, okay. Oh. I was just checking to see. Okay. Because yeah, Marc hasn't told you, but he was also a NERC CSO. At about the time that this
So another interesting vignette, the week after I got to NERC, Stuxnet happened, and Stuxnet dominated my life, as you can imagine, for quite some time.
Well, you're bad luck.
Yeah, because he did so well, DHS wanted him to call it. So DHS, okay, we're getting off topic. But what Mark's talking about is an old school physical attack on the grid, and it's something that we see often during hunting season. Disgruntled deer hunters who haven't killed their big buck, you know, they want to take it out on a line, an insulator, a transformer. This happens, right? What was kind of unique about the Metcalf incident, it wasn't during hunting season, and it happened right next to a well-traveled highway, right next to 101. It was overnight. The cameras picked up all the flashing stuff, but we're talking a few hundred rounds of AK-47 style shoot 'em up, bang, bang. To date, we still don't know who did it. And it also happened simultaneously, and we think there's a connection with cuts to AT&T fiber and some other infrastructure damage that happened all at about the same time. So it wasn't just shooting up the transformers, but there appeared to be other things happening together. And this is kind of what made it a very unique thing because, again, shooting at transformers happens fairly routinely. CIP standards had not really addressed the physical side. It was these standards came out, the reliability standards, came of age in 06, but largely because of what happened in 03 with the Northeast power blackout, as we like to call it, or if you're in Canada, it's the Southeast power blackout. But same thing, which was a result of a tree trimming incident, but it also kind of got everybody's attention that we need to get better at reliability. But there had been nothing put in there about protecting critical substations against physical damage. So when CIP 14 was developed, it was really all about how do we can't remove or bury these large substations. They still have to be above ground, you have airflow around it, and of course you're connecting into transmission and distribution lines. So what you see today across America is most of these substations are surrounded by a wall, and it's designed to be an anti-ballistic wall. Most utilities have done the right thing. They've made the walls look nice. And so you might think that your local utility has put the wall up in order to provide a better view. In other words, you don't see the ugly transformers and wires, you just see this nice little protective wall around it. And actually, it's not a bad thing because it removes the unsightliness. But the intention is to stop a bullet from going through, to prevent somebody from actually hitting the transformer. Or in particular, the bushings and stuff where the line actually comes into the transformer. That's much the piece that it doesn't address is overhead. So what's happened since 2013 is the rise of the drones. And we continue to see this problem as, you know, each Christmas, DJI and these other drone builders come out with cooler and cooler things, and your teenagers are just bound to determine, well, even doesn't take a teenager, sometimes we do this, where can I go with my drone? And going over a substation is an awesome view, you know, when you're looking down at it. Of course, the electronic control from your little device to the drone sometimes gets interfered with the high voltage systems, and a little drone gets confused, doesn't know what to do, and, you know, falls inside the substation. The owner of the drone is left with the option of, do I retrieve my drone? Do I call for help? Do I say nothing? You know, most times these things are already picked up on. So the wall does nothing to stop an overhead. It's purely designed to stop gunfire. But it does, one of the big things that came out of it, you're talking about it takes 6 years to develop a standard. This one didn't take 6 years. This was recognized almost immediately as, well, there is something we can do about this, and we can do it right now. And so that process went very fast. But it doesn't, and this, maybe we can get into this in a moment, the electricity standards, the reliability standards, only apply to bulk power, meaning generation and transmission, but not distribution to your homes or your businesses. And they only apply to those elements of the system that run the bulk power. It does not have anything to do with enterprise IT. So like ransomware, which typically is an enterprise side, there's nothing in the standards that talk about enterprise. And that's by design, because we want to focus it on the physics of the grid and making sure the grid is reliable. But more and more, the enterprise side becomes more connected with the control side. And this is a gap, you know, that we're going to have to address. It has nothing to do with shooting guns at transformers, but but it's yet another maturity level that we need to look at in terms of these standards.
So, and this is a question to everybody, or whoever wants to answer it. So, one of the things that's been a discussion the last couple of years, that the CIP standards are actually a hindrance to the industry, because they don't allow utilities to take advantage of technology. Technology, things like virtualization, like the cloud, like micro-segmentation, like drones, aren't addressed in the standards, and because of the long lead time to develop standards, the electricity industry is missing out on the economic advantages of some of the technologies that we take for granted in the IT business today. So how do we address this? I mean, open discussion.
Well, cloud's a great example, because a lot of power companies want to move the historians and the data gathering and all the functions of running the grid. They want to just put it into the cloud, put it into Google, put it into Azure, you know, put it into Amazon Web Services, whatever. We constantly were getting questions, particularly from Google, how do I make my cloud CIP compliant? Well, it's the wrong question. CIP doesn't apply to you, Microsoft. It applies to the asset owner operator community of the grid. Now, it was not really thought out in the CIP standards of how do you address a supplier? And so there's a whole nother initiative now going in terms of supply chain, and what should we do there? Should a cloud provider be subject to the CIP standards if they want to sell into power, and this would apply, of course, in airlines and other places, or is it up to the asset owner to make some sort of assertion or statement that says, I've inspected this third-party stuff, and I assert that it's CIP compliant, and it's not Microsoft that does it? These are really interesting questions that are unanswered at the moment, and I know Microsoft may or may not want to be subjected to CIP standards. They want the business, right?
So. Well, I want to throw something on that. We keep talking about standards. And first, are there auditors in the audience? Well, so, you know.
Two reluctant hands.
Yes, I know. I saw that. So,
just an elbow.
You,
right?
You might want to run real fast before I make these comments, just so the rest of the audience doesn't gang up on you. But the whole issue we're talking about is much more than a standard, although I'll rail against a standard. I mean, if CIP process wrote the Ten Commandments, it would still be Ten Commandments along with 1,000 pages of assorted guidance and a lawyer or a fleet of them to audit you to see if you're doing it right. And I think that the whole ecosystem is part of what is broken here, as far as, you know, I've got an asset owner operator wants to put it in the cloud. It'll be more secure in the cloud. It'll be more maintainable in the cloud. Everything will work better in the cloud. But the auditor goes, but it's sunny out. Mm-hmm. It's not.
That's harsh.
I'm looking at, you know, 14.3.7.4.9 alpha, and it doesn't say cloud. And where, and you can ask Tom in a second, you go to the next auditor and he'll go, no, it's not 14, da, 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 da. It's 19.6.3.
And so this sounds like a NERC problem, though.
Well, it's an ecosystem
problem. It's an industry problem, not just a NERC
problem. Well, it is a NERC problem.
I mean, NERC
I'm trying to get these guys going here.
Yeah. No, well, my opinion on this is that, you know, I talked earlier about the having the applicability separate from the standards. So my standard, I mean, ideally would be just one requirement, address all the threats on the current list, period. And so the question is, what do they apply to? Well, then in the applicability section, you know, you say this new thing from called the cloud comes along. Well, we're going to address that in the applicability, say this is what cloud is and this is, but how you address a particular threat is not, you know, that's for the cloud, that's not something that's dictated to you. So I think it can be handled, but the whole NERC auditing framework also has to be changed, not only the standards themselves, but the auditing framework as it applies to CIP, because that just, it doesn't work for cybersecurity.
I bet even the auditors agree with that.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're not here, so they can't dispute me.
So we have 10 minutes left. If you have any questions, please step up to the microphones. I have many more questions for these guys. But yes, sir, go ahead, please.
Hi, Dave Weitzel from the NIST National Cybersecurity Center of Excellence. So our first practice guide at NCCOE was integrating energy sector IT and OT in the identity management side, and we put out a multi-hundred page practice guides for the techie, and more importantly, probably a very short executive summary for the people that get to make the big decisions. When we were having that discussion, IT and OT sides were having discussions and said, well, solve this problem for us, because I can shut down somebody's email in seconds, and then substation stuff, well, it might be weeks, and rarely are people killed by email, but as you say, damage to substations. So I would commend that when we think about this stuff, it's nice to talk about regulators, but we're talking about an existential threat to your enterprise. And if you're waiting for a regulator, you're doing the wrong thing, right? So let's not let the regulators get in the way. This is a risk management exercise for corporations. And I think with what we've done with United States Coast Guard in the oil and natural gas industry in the realm of cybersecurity profiles, look, figure out what you do, how you do it, and what controls need to be in place, and tie it to your risk management process, which is tied to your funding process, and get on with it. In this room sits a person from a super major oil company who's leveraged that cybersecurity framework to connect the C-suite to the geek suite in a way that all of those investment decisions are integrated at the corporate level. I was talking to one of the largest oil companies in the planet last week, and they're using cybersecurity framework tied with the the CMMI, so that they have metrics. And on the OT side, they're using the C2M2 model for the metrics. All this stuff's out there. Why should anyone wait?
So thank you for the statement. By the way, I think we would all agree with you on that. And that's kind of the purpose of this conversation, is that the electricity industry is, and many people don't know this, is the only critical infrastructure sector in the nation that has cybersecurity standards. Everyone else
enforceable under penalty.
Enforceable. Yeah. And by the way,
a day if you're in violation. Yeah. Nobody else has that.
So go ahead, Marc.
Well, just on that part, I think very important to realize is that the way that that's set up is that you're not going to fail your way to success, but you will fail your way to a lot of fines. And so it's all driven by an economic, thou shalt follow these long set of rules, or this outside agency is going to fine you. Has nothing to do with follow these rules so you don't blow up, follow these rules so you don't lose electricity, follow these rules for those. You have to do other things to keep your services running.
Yes. Let me make two quick points. For those of you that are in electricity, you know this, but this is mainly for others. The power companies themselves go beyond CIP, as Tom called it. They're a business. If the juice isn't flowing, they're not making money. I mean, it's bottom line. And so they're going to protect their business interests. Unlike a government-run system, I'm not trying to bash the government too much, but if a government system isn't working, okay, so what? And it's not like there's a profit loss cut. So there's a lot of motivation from the business side to keep the stuff working. The other part is that the power companies in the United States and elsewhere are all interconnected. They don't sit as islands. So Duke Power is interconnected with the Southern Company, which is interconnected and interconnected and interconnected. So the CIP standards actually are to the benefit of the interconnections. I actually want my neighbor to be super secure and very reliable because I'm buying and selling power at market prices at the speed of light across these boundaries. If my neighbor isn't reliable, I can't buy reliable power to resell and make money. Or if my neighbor isn't reliable, I can't sell them power for them to purchase from me. And so you see where I'm going here? The standards actually are protecting companies and their interconnected partners so that everybody's at the same level of reliability. It's not about defeating a cyber attacker. It's about making sure we have reliable power. And that's kind of unique to electricity. And again, for those of you who are in power, you understand what I'm talking about. But for everybody else, it's a different concept. The airlines don't have that. If United's airplanes can't fly, there are a few passengers that might be missing a connection to Delta. But in general, most people just stay on United for your connections, or they stay on Delta for your connections. That interconnection that you see in power at millisecond level doesn't really exist in other places, maybe finance, but not so much in the critical infrastructures. And that's a key piece to understanding what we're doing with these standards and where we need to go.
Mark, the Hinsdale fire was in the late 80s, shut down telecommunications network. I think our telecom friends will say that they're in the same boat you are.
Yeah, that's a good point. Telecom, yep. AT&T, Verizon, others, same sort of interdependency.
But I'm going to turn around and throw a little cold water on this from an oil and gas perspective. Let's apply these standards to gas pipelines because they supply energy that produces electricity. Who's going to pay for it? Because the reliability of all these systems is already so high that you're not going to make a substantial dent on a P&L based on outage. What you are going to make a substantial dent on a P&L is costs associated with adding a new compliance program. And so if you added that, for instance, to the natural gas distribution system in this country, your gas price is going to go up substantially in a noticeable amount, which brings up a whole other problem. Regulatory body A says, thou shalt do this. Regulatory body B, the Public Utility Commission, says, yeah, you should follow all those rules, but you can't charge for it.
No cost recovery allowed, yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So,
yes, sir.
Hello, Yang-Gi Kim with SK Telecom in Korea. In Korea, we're starting to think about using true quantum encryption and random number generator to enhance the security of critical infrastructure. And then we're going to extend that to the broader 5G network as a whole, layer by layer. But is there some framework or innovation groups who are thinking that security or encryption aren't to be either on or off? It should be tier levels for whoever needs it at what critical infrastructure?
Yeah, that's a great question.
Boy.
And it depends on the infrastructure. So like the CISRIC group under FCC, you know, has working groups addressing these kind of things with the telcos. But other infrastructures can play there. NERC is not so much into the 3G, 4G, 5G, although this cellular technology is becoming more and more part of the power grid. But it's a great question because it's a cross-infrastructure type of question. It may actually inform us what you guys do in South Korea, where you go with this, can help inform us as to what we need to do on our end.
I agree. I'd really love to follow up and hear how that goes. Yes, sir. We have about 2 minutes left.
So this is related to the question about the lack of good mechanisms for cost recovery and so forth, but I really believe defense can win. I think we've done it before with whether it was ICBMs or whatever. What can we do? What can we change a standard to really spark that space race kind of concept so we win in defense when it comes to our power grid?
Wow, an optimist.
Well,
I'm so happy to hear that.
Yeah. I'm actually going to stand up and say thanks for the question, Brian, and I think that our critical infrastructures are more defensible than our IT infrastructures.
Yes. Yeah.
Because in IT, everything connects to everything, carrying anything, and you really, if you're the network guy, your only control is no latency, please. No speed bumps. Whereas when you get to critical IT, one of the things that NERC CIP really did get right is boundaries. You know, bad stays out there, good stays in here, and we actually fit, you know, put real boundaries in place that are meaningful. And so in critical infrastructures, it is very defensible. It just requires a certain mindset and a certain amount of work to get it done.
And cost recovery is a big deal, as you well know. So please join me in thanking the panel here, and thank you all for attending.
Thank you all.